kill it. Now, okay, how we hear in the Old Testament, they did some things that are pretty atrocious. And they still let their flesh man run, and they still serve God, and God still used them. Right? But we see in the New Testament where God, he said, I didn't come to do away with the law, I came to fulfill the law. Just like adultery. You know, David still got used, but he had to pay the price for the adultery. Now God says, Matthew 5:28 says, if you even look upon a woman and lust after in your heart, you've already committed adultery. So obviously he didn't do away with that law of adultery. He upped the ante. But he also would not, God never asked us to do something that he doesn't give us the tools to do. That's when he said, my grace is sufficient, is made perfect in your weakness. Because he gave us something, the Spirit of Christ, that not only can it raise us from the dead, it can enable us to do what's right. How many have found that to be true in your life?
Yeah.
Just stay with me tonight. God's got a point here. But did it say, have pastor mortify your body? Did it say, have your husband or wife mortify your body? Did it say, call the helpline and have them mortify your body? What did it say? You. Now, what was the key before this? Just stay with me. What was the key before this? You had to be hid in Christ. So you had to kill yourself. So you had to be in. You have to be in Christ before you can kill anything. Come on, this is some good stuff tonight if you'll hang with me. And if you're in Christ, then you have the power to start mortifying those things, which is fornication, uncleanliness, inordinate affections, evil, considerous, covetousness, which is idolatry. And most of you get the gist of what those things are. Amen. And I just want to be really honest tonight. We live in a society that over-sensitizes, it just drills every sense you have. Where can I just share a small nugget God gave me here about a year ago when I was with Pastor Tammy? And I don't have an issue with these things, but we were going somewhere and they were having a downtown, they were having a whole bunch of people that had dressed up in the 1800s and they had their stuff. And the Holy Spirit spoke to me. He said, look at how they're dressed. And so I looked. He said, did that bring up anything inside you that was ungodly? I said, no. He said, were they dressed in burlap sacks? I said, no, they were dressed. They looked nice. They were pretty. You know, the ladies looked pretty. The men looked handsome. He said, but look at how much has become acceptable in the last 100 years. He said, and you all have become so desensitized to it that your senses are overwhelmed. That's why it's such a struggle 24/7. He said, now my spirit is made perfect in your weakness, and I overcome. He said, that's why I teach guys to bounce their heads and ladies to bounce. And I'm not trying to say this, but the enemy has made an onset upon him. Because he knows what these things do to your body, your spiritual body. Amen? But there's also a reason why you need to monitor what comes in. Now, I can't not go to the grocery store, you know. I do swear off certain beaches because I'm not that I have a problem, but I don't want to take my kids someplace where everything's hanging out. Please, I'm not trying to be crashed tonight. Are y'all with me? But I'm also, the Bible says I'm in the world, not of the world. I've got more Christ in me that I can deal with those things. But, you know, here's the problem is in the church we don't deal with how many of these things. Now, I'm not trying to give the enemy any authority here, but he has, in the last days, he has overwhelmed our senses. And how most people in the church decide what is godly is they try to look at the most godliest person around them and see what they're getting by with. Now you wouldn't word it that way, and they sure ain't processing it that way, and they're really not meaning nothing bad by it. But they look around in the culture around them and see what the culture's doing, and they tried to abide by that. I want to encourage us. Now, I'm not talking about going back and being Amish and all that other crazy nonsense. Come on. I'm not talking about taking us back to 100 years. But if nobody, everybody in here kind of has already made this change. Please hear my heart. But let's just talk a little bit. I feel like God wants to talk a little bit about it. But we do it because we love God. We realize that He told us to cut these things off because they cause it. Do you see what I'm saying? But I would say that most people really don't have a clue at how much of this is operating around them because the enemy has purposely oversensitized our culture. I don't believe ladies realize how much they're doing to men, and I don't believe men realize how much they're actually looking already because it's just the norm. I'll leave that at that. Amen. And I'll be honest with you, I don't know where all this is coming from, but Holy Ghost, I believe. I've made a few ladies uncomfortable because they've caught me bouncing my eyes. Now, you'd think they'd be more uncomfortable if they caught me looking, but I'm being really real here, but I've noticed throughout the years I've made them very uncomfortable because I bounce my head away and then they'll readjust or do whatever they need to do. And they get really, and then they're like really embarrassed, and I'm not trying to do anything other than just, you know, hey. Amen. But if I didn't do that, who would I be letting rule me? Because if I had a check, I need to do something about it. But I just want to tell you that as you spend time with God, let Him grow. Don't be surprised when the Word of God blatantly goes against what society's doing, what everybody else is saying is okay. Okay? Y'all with me on that? So, for which thing's sake the wrath of God cometh on the children of disobedience? Oh my goodness. How many want to be in that phrase? Now, here's something else that God spoke to me, I don't know, in the last month or so. You know, I grew up not in a legalistic church, but I grew up around legalistic people and some and things. And the difference between legalism is because I have to. Relationship says I want to. Relationship does it out of love, but it doesn't alleviate the curses that happens when I break God's rules. Okay? And legalism was really, most of people they love God and love people, and they're trying to keep people from getting into messes. They're just going about it all the wrong way. Because the Bible says it's the goodness of God that draws men to repentance. Okay? Are y'all staying with me for a minute? But here's the thing, is that, and let me see if I can get this out. God really spoke to me. Because see, most of the time when we think about wrath and somebody, God punishing these people, disobedience, that's doing these things, of course, we never see ourselves being the bad person. If you do, then you get the fear of God, which is good to an extent. But we see it because what most people picture in their mind's eye is someone that's so angry they're lashing out just to destroy this person because they were bad. Y'all with me? And God said, that is a total wrong image of who I am. There's a wrath coming against those of disobedience, but it's not because He hates them, but it's because He loves them. If I have a child that is totally disobedient and they anger me enough that I have to discipline them, I'm not disciplining them because I hate them, I'm disciplining them because I love them. And we see that over and over again in the Word. But when we read these scriptures, we instantly put on this mad, angry guy who just wants to do us physical harm and kill us. And God says, they need to still see my face of love even when I'm coming after the children of disobedience. Because I'm trying to discipline them to come back to me. I want to make things painful enough that they turn from their wicked ways. I'm here with me tonight. I'm here, and I pray it's a revelation that helps you in whatever it is you're dealing with. I don't know exactly who all I'm talking to here tonight. This is definitely unplanned, but it's from the Lord. I'm here to get some nuggets out of it. Amen. Moving on. In which you also walk sometime when you live in them. Now, a long time ago, God showed me this. If we'll really read this stuff and get us in it, Dennis, it will change us. Notice it didn't say, how humbling is that? when you're talking about the children of disobedience, these people, you know, that are doing all these erasures. Hey, remember when you were? Hey, remember when you were with them and you were doing that stuff? That's what he's saying. Remember when you were one of them? That changes your whole heart about them, don't it? He said, but now you also put off all these. Now, listen. He's like, it's all great that you got rid of, you quit sleeping around and having all those thoughts and doing all that stuff. I'm so proud of you. Then he had to go dig up in our cooler. And put off all of these, anger, wrath, malice. Now, how can he tell us to put off something that he said he himself is doing to the children of disobedience?
That's not our motivation.
It's not our motivation because of love. And because I believe that there's a difference between this wrath, because he's talking about someone who's doing something to get evil. And God's wrath is doing something out of love. Are y'all with me? Now, if you love somebody and you still want to meet them because you love them that much, then we'll come pray for them. Pray for you. They pray for me too. You know? And then malice, you know, just having some. Anybody ever, you know, there's lots of reasons that you have that are legitimate to be upset with someone. But if you really have that against someone, it's only going to affect you. It'll put a malice inside you. Amen? And so he's told us to put these things off. Now, did he say the preacher put them off? Did he tell you have your husband or wife put them off? He said for you to put them off. Now, how can we do that? Because of the one that's in us. Amen? And I realized that, you know, there's some of this stuff I thought, man, I put that off already 3 or 4 times. I got rid of that. God said, you got the first layer. We're just going a little deeper. Yeah, hey, there's been times I've been like, God, I thought we did this like 10 times, and I think I'm getting worse. He said, no, you're just getting down to the meat of things. Come on, are you with me? Because he wants us to be looking more and act like him. He wants us to improve our character and our integrity. Amen? You know, I'll be honest, I really thought I had to, and I've said this before, I thought I had the anger thing down until I had 4 kids and arrived and found in a church all at the same time. And then I realized that I still got upset sometimes and had to repent. But the deal is realizing it before it takes over you. I'm not talking, I'm not an angry guy walking around all the time. Okay, I'm just, if somebody tells me they've never get upset, I'll show you a lie. Whether you do something about it or not, you still have the emotion. It's how you handle the emotion that matters. Amen. All right, so then put off blasphemy. Which is a big deal. You know, a lot of people, they don't really respect God anymore or things going on with him, and they talk however they want. We need to be careful what we say about the Lord, say about the church, say about, you know, his servants. I'm not here to go into all that. But. And then filthy communication out of your mouth. Now, this one, I see people, not only are they drinking anymore, I see Christians that use more swear words than anybody else. And it's just not swear words. Filthy communication, anything that's not edifying to the body of Christ. Anything that would tear someone down is filthy communications. And so, yes, I mean, curse words and all that stuff that the world knows to be derogatory fit right in that. He tells you. And what it is, the Bible says, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth shall speak. So what it is it's a good, you know, and this isn't, remember, this isn't beating you up, this is a daddy who loves you. You know, I can tell you, I can spend just a little time with someone, and whatever's coming out of their hearts is what they've been putting in. It's what they've been meditating on. It's what they've been living. And so, you have to change that. Amen? And, you know, there's so many people, you know, that they've bought into, well, that's just how I am. No, you've just allowed that part of you to stay there. Because old things pass away, behold, all things become new. And that thing is only allowed to stay there because you gave it a legal entry. Amen? All right, moving on. Lie not one to another. Now, we would think that wouldn't even need to be put in when he's talking to a bunch of Christians, would it? It's quiet in here. Let me just be honest, it's still rampant in the body of Christ. Not only
If I had preacher's lie to me and have to be spirit of discernment, I catch people 24/7, and if I called them on every time, they'd be ashamed. But it's easier to pray for them than let them know. I want to let them know when God loves me, tells me to. That's because He's about ready to deal with them. So what am I saying? I'm saying that, you know, my kids, they try to lie to me right now. You know, that on things, and they're learning that, hey, this doesn't pay. You know, for one, Daddy always knows what I'm lying. Number two, you know, this really hurts when I get caught every time, and it never gets me out of anything. But when we lie, it's because we're always thinking of ourselves before we think of others. I was such a... But... And these things here are gateways that open up to the other things that we're talking about. The fornication, all these things. All these things are gateways, and if you fall into these things, those other things will be right behind. Amen. Are you with me? Everybody following me tonight? All right. So, seeing that you have put off the old man with his deeds. You know, I've had a few boxing matches with my old man a time or two when I was younger. You know, that dude, you've got to go in Jesus' name. You know, I can tell you, the old Brian is dead. He's not coming back to life. There's no resuscitating. That guy is dead. Amen. And have put on the new man, which are renewed in the knowledge after the image of Him that created him. So we put on this new man. Now, how do we renew him? How do we make him more like Jesus? What does it say? What does it say? So by the knowledge of the Hindrick, by the Word of God, by putting in the Word of God. But once you get saved, being saved isn't enough. You've got to put in the Word of God that will renew you, spirit man, that will change all these things He's been talking about. That will say, when you're doing something, He'll say, hey, you remember you read over here about this? Let me show you how to deal with that, son and daughter. Let me help you act to be more like me so you can get some more blessings in your life. Amen? All right. So, where there is neither Greek nor Jew, circumcision nor uncircumcision, barbarian, Scythian, bond nor free, but Christ is all and all. I'm so happy I'm grafted into the vine. So many people, listen, I love Israel. I support Israel 100%. So many people are so bound up on the, and there is promises that are made for Israel. But I'm only here to tell you the promises He made in the New Covenant are better than anything He promised to Israel. And Israel will not make heaven if they don't accept Jesus Christ as Messiah. No Jew will make heaven. That is the New Covenant. Some are arguing crazy stuff anymore. I'm just telling you that's the fact. I love Israel, but there's only one way to heaven. And that is through Jesus Christ. But I'm so happy that I'm grafted in the vine. Then we're all the same. You say, why does that matter? Because so many people get hung up on all that. That's just free for you. But put on, therefore, as elect of God, holy and beloved, bowels of mercy. So, He told you what to take out. Did you notice that? Did y'all notice what He told you to take out? Now, most of the time, a lot of times we spend just concentrating on what we're taking out. But He said, when you're taking something out, you got to put something in. How many found that to be true?
Amen.
So put on, therefore, as elect of God, holy and beloved, bowels of mercy, mercies, kindness, and humbleness of mind. I'm here to tell you, if you let your mind go, you won't be a very kind-hearted, humble person. Amen. Those other things will start raging. Meekness and long-suffering. Now, the Lord has grown me in all these areas. Some have a lot more pruning than others. Forbearing one another and forgiving one another. If any man have a quarrel against any, even as Christ forgave you, so also do you. I've preached around this about here a bunch. Be a do-gooder. You got to forgive them. It doesn't matter what they did. Amen? And
above all these things, put on charity, which is the bond of perfection. So let the peace of God rule in your hearts. Now, this is something I've taught a lot of around here. How many here have experienced the peace of God? Remember when you got saved, you felt that peace of God come in. Just, let me tell you, that peace of God is a roadmap to whatever. If it goes, you go. Now, how many other than pastor, you don't have to raise your hand, has lost the peace of God and had to go find where you dropped it? Yeah. You're like, oh man, it is straight up miserable up in here. Where did I take exit left at? Let me go back and get back under that cover. You know, I stepped out over here, that wasn't. So, let the peace of God rule in your heart, which you call one body. So, after you do all these things, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom. Now, that means that you can, you know, the Bible says that the letter killeth, but the spirit give life. There's people that can quote you scripture after scripture, and they're as dead as a doornail. Because they're not letting it live in them and give them wisdom. You know how they, you know how you can tell when the Spirit is giving someone wisdom? They're responding to what it's speaking to them. It's wisdom because they're already applying it in their own life. Come on. Anybody can tell you what it says. They can even tell you that in the society we live in today, information is everywhere. They can get it broke down for you and tell you all the stuff about it and never once even know how to apply it. Amen? So then teaching and admonishing one another in psalms. Now, I'm going to stop here for a minute. I'm just going to kind of go on a little small thing. Anybody know what a psalm is? What's a psalm? So is that a, if we are teaching and admonishing, that means correcting, encouraging, lifting each other up in psalms, are we singing what somebody else has written, or are we singing what God has given to us? All right. And now today there's kind of, God's put this on my heart to have this at Broken Kings for years. We're still not there yet. We've had some in the past. I mean, we had some of this in the past. But some people call it prophetic worship. They call this and that. But it's something that the body of Christ desperately needs. But see, it flows out of what you have already gone through, all these processes. Now, how many have enjoyed some of the processes we just talked about? But how many are ready to use them for teaching and admonishing your brothers and sisters that might be going through the same process? Are you starting to get a revelation? You know, and the thing is we've been so taught that unless we're like this, I joke about singing solo, so you can't hear me, you know. And the Lord's had me sing a few prophetic songs, and I was very uncomfortable. I'll be honest, I'm not a singer. I don't like to sing, and I don't like to get up front of people and sing. Some people, that's their calling. It's not mine. But that doesn't mean that God can't use me to speak something through someone that way. Amen? So, what did I say all that for, which I'm not done yet? Is even those things you're going through, as God is growing you, they have a purpose for the body of Christ. They have a huge purpose. Amen? Anybody start to click some stuff together? So, admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. So, how many have ever sung spiritual songs, speaking in tongues? Amen. How many sees where God just sometimes wants you to get lost and all that stuff, just get lost with him, and all that stuff that you've been going through, he wants to use it to minister to somebody else. I spoke the last time I was here, it was a phenomenal word. I don't mean that from me, I mean from God. And, you know, you're not just here trying to get through something. You're not a hamster on a wheel. God's got a call for you. This is a special life he's given to you. He's got things only you can do, and he wants to bless you. We have a great place. This ain't our home. We've got a great place in heaven that's coming. But there's so many things he wants to start using you in the body of Christ and using the things you want to go through. But see, the enemy keeps us focused on what we're going through, even on sometimes whenever we're working on the things we need to take out. We get so focused on what we're taking out, we don't concentrate on what we should be putting back in. And some people, unfortunately, get more focused on trying to put something in and never take nothing out, and they get stuck in a stalemate. Amen. Are y'all getting something out of this tonight? And so we're just going to grow with it as God shows us. We're going to read verse 17. And whatsoever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, giving thanks to God and the Father's by Him. And I will not touch the next verse tonight after the Adam and Eve story. Amen. Glory to God. So I'm going to just take a few minutes. That's about all I got left. We were going to have praise and worship tonight. Pastor Tane was all prepared. But I just felt, I'm trying. Y'all help me. In my heart is to encourage you all. I want to say something like, I know we're light on numbers, but God's here. I know y'all have been going through a lot. And I do know all those things, and that's why I say that. But I really want to try to stop talking about the numbers at all and just get on with what God's called us to do. And, unless He sees fit. Because, God has sustained us. He's kept us. He's kept us as a church. You all are doing awesome work. We're coming up the 1st of June. We're going to have a Sunday and talk about all the different ministries that God is doing through here and what they're doing, who they're reaching again. How many want to hear some of that? Amen. All the souls that are being reached. And we're going to have that coming up. But, sometimes you just got to get lost in the Lord. Sometimes, I know I've said this before, there's so many things in my life that I went through, and even I believe I'm going through, that have been even for somebody else. But here's the key. I never got to quit going through them until I got what He wanted me to get out. Even if they were for somebody else. Because my character and integrity can always come up. I've got a long way to go to be like Jesus. But I'm never going to quit trying. And why am I doing that? Because I want them to... I'm the only Jesus people are ever going to see. I know most people here that are here tonight, y'all have been walking through some things. And I just want to encourage you, take some stuff out. Make sure you're putting some stuff back in. And wherever you're doing, follow the peace of God. He'll guide you through whatever circumstance you're going through. And He'll fill you with joy and peace through the power of the Holy Ghost. He'll comfort you. Also, Sister Barley lost her mom this week. I've been praying for them. Y'all be praying for them. It's a rough transition. Can't imagine. Mine's going to live to be 120 this week. I have anything to say about it. Amen. But how many here tonight, if you had one thing to say to your brothers and sisters in the Lord, what would you say tonight to them? Speaking to God. I want everybody to participate, if you will, please. Because if you're, think about it this way, somebody's going to share and it's going to minister to you and what you have than what they need. So don't cheat somebody else out of it if you're going to receive something. And I feel that for stand up, Sister Bonnie, if you would, and share with us.
I would just say that.
Well, here, won't you come on up here? We want to, I want to make sure they hear. Listen, this is from the Word of God. This is not just, amen. You can even sing it if you want.
I would just say, as a word of encouragement, even though you may not see what God's doing in, on your behalf, and you may not even think things are moving, He is moving. Things are being done. And when it's revealed, you're going to be blown away.
Amen.
You just have to have the faith, and if you will not faint, you know.
Amen. How's that new job coming? Are you finally signed the papers?
Well, in the spirit.
Brother Kevin, can you come on up so everybody can hear? Hey, let me just tell you, some of you are thinking, well, I ain't got nothing to share. I call bull hockey. Tell them devil to shut up. You got plenty. You're sitting here tonight on a Wednesday night in the house of God. You are a champion.
To go on kind of along Donnie's line, the only way you lose is if you quit.
Right.
He is your strength. He will keep you moving. Keep your eyes on Him. He'll keep you on the target. So don't give up. Don't give in.
Amen. I like the only way He wins is if we quit.
That's it.
Glory to God. Somebody else tonight. Come on up. You got something, honey?
Right,
we'll let you share. Well, here, tell them.
If I was to encourage anybody, I would say God is faithful no matter what you're going through, whether you understand it or not. If you let Him, He will carry you through and He will walk you through with it and He will be with you. But the key is you have to give Him control. But He is faithful.
Amen. Praise God. He is faithful. And you don't have to wait to be called on. Just run on down when the next one gets done.
I just have to say those things that you think that are impossible in your life and you think you'll never overcome, it is possible through Christ.
Amen. If you had one thing to encourage your brothers, sisters, and Lord, what would it be?
Stay strong, because you don't know how your life is affecting someone else who's looking to you as a Christian, as a man of God, or a woman of God, you make a difference in the people you touch.
Amen.
I think he took what I was going to say, but I was going to say, God is faithful no matter what you're going through. He's always faithful, always comes through, and don't grow weary, but be strengthened in the Lord and what He's doing in your life. Know that you're victorious day in and day out. Living the Word, you're victorious every day. The Word says you're walking triumphantly in Him day in, day out. So you have the victory, and so we get to walk that out with our heads held high, knowing God is in control.
Amen. Amen. All right, we're down to the three young ladies.
It's always easier to do it on His will and not yours. But there's, I'm serious. You get so many more blessings doing it His way. And you do get to see beauty come out of these things. You do get to see things restored when you didn't.
think it was going to happen, or he didn't know what was going to happen. And I'm seeing that in my family, and I don't see it with Bryce's family. So it's beautiful.
Amen. Nothing like doing it God's way. Amen. All right. Eeny, meeny, miny, moe. You're like, he seriously won't call me out, really.
Yes.
Thank you all for sharing. How many got something out of that? Felt something deposit in your spirit.
Amen.
Amen. I mean that's the word alive. I felt nuggets just being deposited in my spirit. See y'all, put up that other slide that says the treasure is within you if you can. Save the service. Well, boy, it'll get there. But the truth is that he's put this treasure within us. No, there's another slide adding to service. There we go. 2 Corinthians 4:7. But we have this treasure in an earthen vessel, that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us. And see, tonight, each one of you have a treasure that God's put inside you, that He's refined as you walk through all those things we talked about, so that the excellency of the power can be of God. Amen? And tonight, each one of you, you took a little bit of nugget out of your treasure chest. You opened up your treasure chest. That's what that verse talks about. That's why it's so powerful to do. You opened up your treasure chest tonight, and you took out one of those precious nuggets that you'd walk through, that you went through the fire to acquire. And you took that, you deposited, see, that into your brothers and sisters, and you shared that with them tonight. Isn't that good? Amen. I pray tonight minister to you. I pray you're happy you came to church. I'm so happy to be here with you all. I'm still resisting, but I'm getting better. More than an overcomer through Christ Jesus. Amen. So y'all keep praying for me. And this coming Sunday, just show up. It'll be good. I usually don't tell a lot because nobody comes, but y'all are usually the ones that come no matter what. Me and Pastor Tammy have had it's not our vacation, but we've had a break planned for a few months. So we were planning, we've already had arrangements to be out of town this weekend. And God willing, and my... Let's cooperate. We will not be here Sunday. We'll be in the house of God, just not here. And then I'm looking forward to coming back the following Sunday. And after that, I'll be here that next Wednesday. And I'm looking forward to just having a blowout in the Holy Ghost. Amen. So y'all be ready. Don't be discouraged. There's nuggets that was here tonight. You know, Brother Oglesby, he had a sign made up at his church years ago. I saw as I was listening to y'all tonight, I thought, boy, that just might fit right here. He had a big sign up there that said, God is faithful. And, you know, if you can sum it up in one thing, everything you've been through, you can say, God is faithful. He hasn't always done it the way I thought. He didn't do it when I thought. Didn't do it how I thought. But when I let him, you know, when I lay down me, like we said in that verse, and let him have his way, he's never once failed. Amen. All right. Well, we're going to dismiss because I'm running really late. And I think they have something for you next door, Pastor Teddy. Yeah. You need to go over there and check it out. Yeah, everyone is invited to go over there and check it out with us. You're dismissed. Oh, tithes and offerings. I hadn't forgotten in so long.